Okay, great. We have a very exciting event in front of us. It's an event where we will be able to discuss each other's work and gain feedback from the various aspects of the ANTICORRP. And I know that we have a couple of external audience here with us today. And for those of you who may not be as familiar with the ANTICORRP, I just wanted to say a couple of words about the program to introduce you to the event.
Paschalis wants to be first.
The ANTICORRP is an acronym for Anti-Corruption Policies Revisited, Global Trends in European Responses to the Challenges of Corruption. And it's a large-scale European research consortium funded by the European Commission. We currently involve 20 research institutions from 15 European countries. And we have gathered here for a couple of days to discuss each other's work. And we ask questions, or we all seek questions, the answer to the question of how to develop effective and well-working anti-corruption policies and how to promote better quality of government. And we do this from a number of different angles. And one of the particular strengths of the ANTICORRP is that we involve not only a large number of countries, a large number of institutions, but we also involve a large number of different disciplines. So we have sociologists, political science, history, public administration, and I'm still probably forgetting one of two or two of you here. And I think that in a sense, the ANTICORRP, to me at least, is perhaps a unique opportunity for corruption research in Europe, in the sense that it allows us to bring together various research strands and try to find empirical and theoretical common ground between researchers. And this event that we will hold today, tomorrow, and on Wednesday, is one step in that process. And my hope for participants in this event is that you would be able to gain feedback on your work from somewhat unexpected perspectives. So the goal, as I see it with the ANTICORRP, is not to make research run as smoothly as possible. The goal is rather to get a broader perspective on where we can direct our efforts in anti-corruption in the future. And for that, I believe that we need a variety of different institutions and a variety of different perspectives. And we need to begin to interact better to find workable solutions and to improve corruption research in Europe in order to promote better quality of government in the long term. So we will start off this event with a roundtable discussion.
It's rectangular, actually. But
it's a long table discussion, not a round table discussion at this point. We have Paschalis Kitromilides, a professor from the Kapodistrian University, also here in Greece. We have Drago Kos, who is the chair of the OECD Anti-Bribery Group. And we have Professor Nikos Passas also with us today to join in the discussion. And the discussion will be moderated by Professor Alina Mungiu-Pippidi, who is a professor at the Hertie School of Governance. But before we kick off this event, I would very much like us to have a couple of words from our hosts that have agreed on helping us organize this event. So please give a hand for Dia from Ilya Met that will represent the efforts of hosting us here.
Okay, literally a couple of words. I have on behalf of Elia Mep and on behalf of my colleagues, Evangelia Psikoyopoulou and Dimitris, whom I cannot see, would like to welcome you here in Athens and to the fourth meeting of the ANTICORRP project. I just hope that you enjoy your stay here and that the meetings in the next 2 days are productive and stimulating for all of us and learning as usual. So thank you.
Thank Thank you very much, everyone, and to people who have perhaps tuned in Berlin or in Brussels or wherever our correspondents are, welcome from Athens. This is the roundtable of the ANTICORRP project, which starts the last consortium meeting of this research project. Now, without further ado, let me start the discussion with this distinguished panel that we have managed together. I think that we are very proud in the ANTICORRP project that we have seen in the past 2-3 years how our ideas about corruption are little by little getting acknowledged. And I think it was one of our quite important ideas that corruption should not be seen at an individual level, but rather as a governance phenomenon, as a whole regime, really. And we have always argued that from this perspective, it's favoritism and government favoritism, which is the major problem. And the bribe, it's either a way of getting access or in fact, making favoritism happen. And it's been a time when we were pushing this idea very much from the margins. But I'm very much afraid that now with the Panama Papers, this is becoming a more mainstream idea than we would have thought of. So my first really question to the members of our panel is, what is this Panama Paper telling us about the Western European elites and about the countries that we generally tend to present as being well-governed countries, in opposition with the poorly governed countries, which are supposed to learn from them and import through norms transferred all this wonderful anti-corruption made of great tools that we've been studying. In other words, is this a revelation of something past and simply showing that transparency is increasing and we find out what goes on? Is this a positive phenomenon or actually the other way around? What happened with the world that we were mapping in comparative politics and which had the green part, the nicely colored green countries, and the red part, the countries where corruption was on the majority, right? Like World Bank nicely took from us and put in the World Development Report last year, when corruption is a norm. This used to be the main concern of ANTICORRP, countries where corruption is the norm. Are there still such countries? Are there other countries as well? And I would like to start with Professor Paschalis Kitromilides, who is on the advisory board of the ANTICORRP project and whose entire work actually has been about change in particularistic countries. He has published widely with Princeton University Press and Oxford. And his last book is very topical. It's called The Making of Modern Greece and was published by Harvard University Press in 2013. So is Greece an example of how particularistic countries change eventually with Europeanization, crisis, or whatever other factors of change exist? Pascal, please.
Well, thank you, Alina, very much for including me in this and not thinking that work in the history of political thought is irrelevant to these burning contemporary issues. I asked to be given the privilege to speak first in this long table because I, as a resident in this city, I wanted to welcome you all here and to say how pleased I am that the consortium is having a meeting in Athens. This is a great city of art and culture, so I hope you will have a chance to see a little of this heritage beyond this wonderful picture we have across from us of the Temple of Olympian Zeus. At the original inception of the keynote discussion, we were asked to think and talk about what primarily interests us. And in my case, this is reflection on the problem of corruption in the long tradition of the history of political thought. And I just wanted to remind you, by being as laconic as possible, that this reflection the appraisal of the incidence of corruption in societies is not a new problem. It is present in ancient Greek political thought, in the fundamental works of normative political reflection, which talk primarily about the good order of government, ευνομία, and worry about the threats to this Solonian concept of eunomia emanating from sectional particularist interests and self-seeking of individuals, and this is the problem of corruption. We have it, if I may remind you, in Plato's Republic, the last three books in this fountainhead of all political reflection are devoted to the problem of corruption, which has to do with the self-seeking of private interests on the part of individual members of the community. And in Aristotle also, corruption is a major concern because it is the product of inequality which motivates stasis, continuous unrest in cities, which again, it's unrest which upsets and overturns the ideal of the good ordered government. So it has been there all along. But in modern political thought, I think the primary source is the work of Machiavelli, who talks about corruption as the major problem of setting up a viable modern community. And when I think of corruption, what comes to mind is what he has to say about his native city of Florence, where we met 3 years ago, in his Florentine Histories, where he bemoans the problem of self-seeking and self-interest, which operates first as a motivation of dissension and factionalism, and then as an obstacle to the setting up of a well-ordered community, a republic governed by law. And among the many things that Machiavelli warns about is the threat emanating from all these sectional and private interests which motivate dissension against the pursuit of public interest, and he seeks in an entirely empirical way to locate the symptoms. When does corruption begin? Where does it lead? How it is expressed? And it is very interesting to look at what he says and compare to what is happening today. And occasionally one has very sobering thoughts about these things, which lead us back to certain of his, Machiavelli's, own admissions about the fickleness of human nature. So this is a normative aspect which I'm interested in thinking about corruption, and I wanted to share with you. Now, the other question which Alina just posed concerning contemporary Greece. I don't think I will want to say much. I don't know much. I haven't been reading all these very learned reports on the economic crisis and its causes. But I wanted to say only one thing, and then I could come back to it. That we may think of societies, and this is my indirect response to Alina's opening question, marked by endemic corruption, which is a historically controllable fact. But I think it would be wrong to look at this division of the map the way Alina described it earlier, sort of the green and red, the green, clean areas of the world, and make arguments, essentialist argument, about corruption as germane to certain types of society. I think this is historically and sociologically unfounded and wrong, and it is a kind of cover not only of ignorance, but also of other motivations as well. So I think we should make clear distinction between endemic and germane. And germane is not something that you could ascribe to any society. So this is the focus of my own reflections. And I have tried in the book that Alina was kind enough to mention, in a way to connect certain themes in the Greek ideological and political tradition with some of the moral problems involved in the current crisis. And perhaps we could come back to that at a later stage in the discussion. So this is from me at the moment.
Thank you very much, Paschalis, for reminding us that actually in the tradition of political theory, people expected good government to come about as a result of altruism, right? Because in modern political science, we expect good governance to come about as a result of selfishness and of what we call, you know, utility. We are expecting at the end of utility to find somehow all these utilities combine into good government. So maybe this presumption is wrong, and it's one of the interesting things that we may want to discuss. I will move now to our next speaker, who happens to be also a Greek. So you see we are trying to, you know, feature the fact that we are in Athens. We're also very pleased that the good governance words were said in Greek. I could not have done this myself, so I'm pleased to find the guests to do this. And our next speaker is Professor Nikos Passas, who is the distinguished inaugural professor for, hold on, collective action, business ethics, and compliance with the International Academy of Anti-Corruption in Luxembourg, Vienna. He is the only person who is not directly associated with the ANTICORRP project, so we are very happy and grateful for him for joining this panel today. So where is Greece towards the rest of the world, and are we moving, you know, we are scared of more corruption due to more transparency, or is actually far more corruption than we thought?
Good afternoon, everybody. Starting with the Panama Papers, a quick observation is that a lot of the activities that are being revealed are in fact allowed by the law. These are the things that I have called lawful but awful, because when you look at the effects of these practices, they are worse than organized crime. So when that happens, the law must change. And simply because they are legal, it doesn't mean that we must not discuss reforms and corrections. I would like to make 4 points, using Greece as an illustration, but they are broad challenges and they affect the international arena where I have been active in the last 3 decades. The first one is about international governance. It is about the assessment, and accountability, openness and accountability of international organizations and institutions. When you look, for example, what's been happening in Greece in the last few years, it has been held out that this is a Greek bailout, that Greece is receiving tons and tons of money from the north, and the press has gone crazy about how hardworking northern Europeans are supporting lazy Greeks. In my TED talk last year in Athens, I referred to a German study that established that if Greece defaulted completely, the German treasury would have been better off by 10 billion euro, because the Greek crisis and the way things evolved from there lowered significantly the borrowing costs for the German treasury. That is, if no single euro were paid back if Greece declared bankruptcy. A second study came out a couple of weeks ago, and that established that out of the first and the second bailouts, only 5% of the funds went to the Greek budget. The bulk of it went to bail out financial institutions and private creditors. This was the bailout of banks, not the bailout of Greece. So we've had a series of austerity measures which predictably made the debt less sustainable and added economic, social, and humanitarian disasters that Greece is still suffering from. When we have this insistence on legal practices and measures that have predictably this kind of catastrophic consequences, it amounts to regulatory fundamentalism. And that is not something that can build trust in institutions. And there we have another trust crisis with international organizations. So, context. Trust in institutions and viable reforms are important, and that has to do with international organization, openness, and accountability. The second point is that standard setters, implementers, evaluators, and national authorities have been throwing law and institutions at the problem of corruption, formalizing the whole process, check-the-box kind of assessment tools. Then we use also TI's perception index and all those other kind of things. And we forget the goal, the outcomes. What's the point of having all this? How do we improve governance? How do we achieve trust and economic growth and quality of life? So this kind of formalizing process, in fact, defeats the purpose because the purpose gets lost. And that applies to the private sector as well, by the way. What you have is compliance rather than ethical implementation of rules. Lawyers are there in order to make sure that the company stays out of trouble with the law, and they do things that may actually not let them sleep well at night. Well, we have to improve the quality of sleep of executives as well. The third point is that when it comes to Greece, we see lack of continuity. We see lack of strategic thinking and implementation of reforms. Five political parties have come to government in the last 4 years or so during the crisis, all of them with an anti-corruption agenda, and none of them has actually accomplished very much. Instead, what we have seen, a series of changes in laws, institutions, processes, and people in those institutions. So, how can you do anything sustainable with this? There is no proper diagnostic on the basis of which a strategy can be built. And there is no collective action effort so far to connect the different stakeholders, civil society, private sector, academia, media, political parties, and government, so that we can actually do something. And the one thing that everybody in Greece agrees about is that those reform and measures and conditions imposed on Greece are unacceptable. And yet, there has been a complete failure to actually articulate jointly an alternative discourse, an alternative position, an alternative path. And that is where the big challenge in Greece, I think, is. So, anti-corruption bodies do not have any independence. Anti-corruption functions are very fragmented. And while we have pockets of excellence and integrity, we do not have the capacity that it takes. We need to do some additional capacity building. My last point is that we keep focusing on the negative. We need to focus on the positive as well. Take a look at the refugee crisis. Despite the social melancholy and financial catastrophe in Greece, you find Greek people more welcoming, more heartwarmingly welcoming of refugees than societies that are much better off. What you have is old ladies knitting clothes for the children. You have supermarkets collecting food and distributing in the camps. This place, this people, has a big heart. Instead of wounding it further, we need to nurture it and support it. We need to identify in anti-corruption as well these pockets of integrity, identify the anti-corruption leaders, recognize them, support them, and create those sustainable processes for reform towards better governance, quality of government, and happiness. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed, Nikos. Here is Greece, where there's not much action. I didn't mention the fact that I am Romania. There is a country with a lot of action. 18 ministers had been put in jail in the past 2 years alone. Prime Minister had to lost office because he was indicted in last October. The current president just lost his house in a lawsuit where the civil court established that actually he might have been able to purchase this house due to a fraud. So he's now afraid he might actually be pursued for fraud. And if you look at the face of it, it's a lot of activity, let alone our civil society activity, everything that Greece seems to miss. However, I polled this country 2 weeks ago, and only 12% of Romanians said that it's less corruption than it was before. All the rest were highly pessimistic that the country is as corrupt as it can be, despite the fact that really there's nobody left to be put in jail. I mean, a person is not able to be 3 months a minister without going to jail. Obviously, because if you are a minister, you have to be there and continue to provide money for the parties. So here we are in this amazing situation in which individuals have a very high cost, but practices don't really change, right? So my question to our next and very distinguished speaker, who is Drago Kos, who is the chair of the Working Group on Bribery at OECD, is really, does anybody really change? Do we have any signs that international anti-corruption is working anywhere? And what are we really getting so wrong that we arrest so many more people than we did before with so little change?
Well, thank you, Alina. I will try to respond to you to the last question first. You see, if you have a tree where nobody is bumping in, of course, when the first wind comes, you know, the fruits, the pears, the apples, the plums will come down. And this has happened in Romania, you know, because in Romania they had the all anti-corruption infrastructure in place for years, and they were not allowed to do anything. So now when things have grown up so much that they were allowed to do something, now the riskiest, let's say, profession in Romania is to be a minister. Nobody wants to be a minister anymore, so, because they arrested all the past, the current, and the future ministers already. although this might, see, usually I'm being, let's say, accused that my speeches are very pessimistic, that I'm predicting that everything is going wrong, but this time I will start the other way around, thanks to your question. Things are moving, things are changing, but they're not changing, let's say, in big steps. They're changing in millimeters. What I see in the international community is basically the following. We knew already that they're, well, if you want, instead of they, decision makers, politicians, high-level public officials, are saying one thing, are doing something completely different. But we did know that the difference is so huge. What we saw in the last years with so many leaks in different areas, including the last one on Panama Papers. But just remember the LuxLeaks. Remember, there is also a case which is not so familiar here in Europe. It's called Yuna Oil, which basically concerns Australia and Oceania there. So we are getting more and more information on how systematically, even if the legal rules are not being breached, things are going wrong. And yes, of course, it is more transparency. Yes, of course, it is that whistleblowers are learning more and more how to do it and still stay anonymous. But this is, again, showing that the international community is not composed mainly of protecting big ideas, protecting big ideals, protecting human rights, liberties. It is still, unfortunately, about protecting their own or our own pecuniary and similar interests. And this is what is going on. So this is the enemy we are fighting. When I used to work in Greco, I was, let's say, chairing some 40 countries. And I was so proud because I had the impression that they all want to fight corruption. This is the impression which I lost years ago already, you know, because not all of the countries taking part in international anti-corruption activities are doing this because they would really like to change something. They're there to protect their images. They're there to control the damage which can be caused to them by the international organizations. And only some of them are really trying to do something. And they, of course, they do it in different periods of time. So even if you would expect that if we accept, if we adopt, let's say, international convention yesterday, we would expect that all countries which have ratified today, they will start doing something tomorrow. In some cases, it is in 2 years, some cases it is in 10 years. We have, since I'm chairing the OECD Working Group on Bribery, have countries which after 16 years of the ratification of the our convention have not implemented all parts of the convention yet. Countries which are members of G8, the most important countries of the world economically. So, and this is something I think we will have to adjust to. So forget the, let's say, very noble ideas on fighting for good, improving the world. No, we will have to face the reality. We are still fighting very particular, very individual, very separate interest of countries, which do things only if they feel that they will have something to gain from that, and they don't do things which don't think they will benefit from them. This has been proven not only in the area of anti-corruption. Let's take a look on the refugee crisis. The whole system in Europe has fallen apart. And Europe was built on the idea of humanity and the idea of, let's say, let's help other people. It does not exist anymore. So, but still it is moving. We see, let's say, we in the OECD, we see that countries are doing more and more in the fight against bribery. They do, statistically and otherwise. Of course, not all the countries do it in the best or in the ideal terms, but still things are moving. Let's take Germany, for example. Now, Germany was just 15 years ago, German companies could deduct taxes on the bribery paid. Germany was the last country in the European Union to ratify the United Nations Convention Against Corruption. In Germany, you don't have any specialized anti-corruption institution. Well, what I'm saying this, it doesn't mean that anti-corruption institution is very solid proof that something is going on in the country. But Germany is now making big steps forward. They have 3 laws in the pipeline. They have really started developing a practice which is going against, let's say, corrupt practices in the last years. And I can list you some other examples too. The problem is there are not all the countries doing so, not all the countries with the same speed, not all the countries with the same motivation. And as long we will have, let's say, countries which are among the most important ones in the world, and they don't want to listen to any anti-corruption standards, and I'm not speaking about implementing them, but just to bring them into their national legislations, then of course we have a big problem, which is, for them, it is even easier when they see, because they can put the fingers on all of us saying, yeah, you have ratified this and this convention, you're saying you're implemented the standards, but LuxLeaks, Panama Papers, WikiLeaks, Una Oil are very simple evidence that you're just talking about what you're not doing.
Thank you very much, Drago. So the question is really, you know, with all the LuxLeaks, Panama Leaks, and with the Volkswagen affair, which we should not forget, is that who is in the situation of telling these reluctant countries what to do? Who still has the high moral grounds? I mean, we are in Greece. I mean, that's a problem. And the fact that all this crisis debt problem got mixed with the other, the anti-particularism efforts, I'm not sure it was really a help. So really, let me put it like this. Who are our allies in favor of change presently? Who are the groups who really want to change these countries? I mean, we're very proud that in the ANTICORRP project we had historians, for instance, a group of historians and a group of anthropologists. This was not a purely dedicated applied policy project. And one of the interesting things in history is to see that there were groups on whose interest was to promote good governance. They didn't do it out of sheer altruism. The British merchants of the 18th century, it was in their best interest to get government out of their business because they already had a competitive advantage. They didn't need public contracts for the government to close with a profit. They actually had a profit. They had large markets in front of them, and what they needed was that the government doesn't pass poor regulation to prevent them, right? Who are the equivalent of these people? Who are the equivalent of the British merchants or as the British barristers who, in order to promote their own cases in courts, actually pushed ahead procedures in a way which brought about good governance? Who are the groups that we rely on in this crusade. Others, I mean, other groups than people who do what the American political scientist Mark Warren called the regulation of anti-corruption appearances, but not the regulation of anti-corruption. Who wants to go first?
May I grab the mic first? No, because this is, you're tackling something which I'm thinking about it, let's say, in the last year. Sometimes I have the impression that while we are talking to the governments, we have almost come to the end of their, let's say, results. Either the governments, they can't do more or they don't want to do more. We are jumping on the governments, we are telling them, first, we set the standards, we're introducing different sorts of monitoring mechanisms, and then we apply different sorts of sanctions. But I see an emerging power which can do, I think, even much more. And this power will have to take the role of your merchants, and this is the private sector. Now, if somebody needs clear rules, if somebody needs good governance, if somebody needs to know what exactly will happen if they do this and this and this, those are private companies. And I can see in more and more countries that really the private sector is raising its voice. The private sector is demanding from the governments, listen, if you want to have a productive private sector, if you want to collect the taxes, we simply need this, this, and this. And what they demand from their governments is not, or is usually very, we would say in our terms, let's say, very with high level integrity, honesty, and so on and so on. Of course, not always, but in majority of cases, this is the case. The problem we have is that the governments are still perceiving the private sector as some sort of, let's say, they don't trust it. They think the private sector, all demands for the private sector are there just to make the life of the private sector easier, that means lower taxes, and so on and so on. But this is not the case. Private sector is really eager to do something. We just have to push it a bit. We just have to help the private sector, and we have to assist them in pushing the governments to regulate things, not only regulate, to bring them into life in practice too. And when I say private sector, of course, I also include the, let's say, the civil society, which is always an important part of our society. The problem is that although civil society usually is spending much more time and energy on thinking how to improve the living conditions of the citizens and the companies, they're usually not so much listened to by the governments because they're not producing anything which would be worth taxation. Companies do. That's why companies are so important. We had cases in the history, let's say, of the Working Group on Bribery, where we have threatened one of the biggest countries of the world that we will apply some measures which would badly hit the companies, their companies. They have changed the legislation immediately, the legislation which was in place for more than 100 years. They changed it just because they got afraid that we would really tackle their private sector. We should feel really bad consequences.
Yes, please. You have your own microphone.
Yeah. Well, I guess from what has been said up to now, and with that historical reference you gave, which I could supplement with one of the papers we have been reading for this meeting, the paper on Dutch society and the control of corruption in the Netherlands, I think the answer is the allies in the anti-corruption struggle will be found in a stronger civil society. And the problem in countries like Greece is that civil society has been weak and dependent on the public sector and on handouts from the public sector, which makes it unable to resist all these phenomena of corruption. So what you need is a stronger civil society, one important part of which will be agents of economic activity and development who will want some public order to prevail, and therefore, as we're just hearing from Drago, would be able to put up resistances to motivations of corruption. And therefore, the question will be how to strengthen and encourage and develop civil society in countries which are plagued by corruption, by endemic, what I said before, endemic forms of corruption.
Yes, please.
So examples from Greece of where you can start. I mentioned some pockets of excellence. There is, from the side of the government, there is the Open Government Initiative, the AVIA, where they publish as much information as becomes available. You have the city of Athens that publishes a lot of the public information, financial information, and you have a LAC, a civil society organization with open source. They're trying to collect from all municipalities and cities around Greece. Information becomes available, make it uniform, put it out up online, and increase citizen participation and accountability. There are also, I've been trying to meet in the private sector, anti-corruption integrity leaders in Greece, and there are several who are value-driven. They want to have the predictability. They have seen the value of ethical as well as law-based compliance. But here we have to be realistic as well. Ernst & Young just published a study, and they found that 42%, it was a global survey, 42% of those respondents, they said that they find it acceptable if their company used unethical conduct in order to achieve financial ends. This day and age, and if you take into account that this is self-reporting, you can expect that this underestimates the willingness of people to participate in those things beyond the 42%. All right? So here is where you have to think about the longer term. And as researchers, I think that finding incentives for doing the right thing is the key. Finding what helps the bottom line in the private sector, what is in it for economies, what is in it for governments, political parties, and so on. So these need to be documented, visualized, and conveyed, communicated in an easy to understand, policy useful way. On the longer term, again, as researchers and academics, we have the duty to prepare the next generations. It's going to be a multi-generational issue project. Culture of integrity doesn't happen from one day to the next. We have to train, we have to create the generations that will participate both in the private and public administration. Okay, so if you look around, many universities do not have courses. If you look around, we have scarcity of good data, good analysis. That is where the capacity building at the university and in the schools, that's where our responsibility is to contribute to the culture of integrity that we need for the future.
Thank you. Well, we have, let's say, by now established that there's a wide variation of motivations across countries to reform, but also countries sometimes receive quite poor international advice, I would say, right? And they're not really steered right by the international community in order to reform their governance. And I think that in the Anticorp project, we have been studied and come up with quite a lot of such evidence. You know, I think in Mishi's work, for instance, he has shown that EU funds indeed can create incentives for corruption rather than disincentives. So Mr. Varoufakis, since we are in his countries, was not entirely derailed when he said that that EU funds in fact reinforced the structure of clientelism in these countries. And also in Ramin's work and other work of people here, they have also shown that quite a lot of common anti-corruption instruments recommended to countries don't work. Countries which adopt these instruments don't progress more than countries which don't. I think the last horrible findings I found out from Anticorp project were that the more party finance restrictions countries adopt, the more corrupt party finance they have, all right? So yes, I took in what Nikos says earlier, when an immoral practice becomes so widespread, the law has to change. But what laws exactly? I mean, how would we know the good laws, the effective laws, from the poor laws we have been really flooding the countries with? Because presently we have the most anti-corruption, the lengthiest anti-corruption legislation exists in the most corrupt countries, as in the old Latin saying, you know, the most corrupt countries has the most laws. I mean, my country has quite a lot of anti-corruption legislation, and it has no or very little competitive private sector to do what you just said. Most of its private sector has just thrived on state contracts, so that what they're doing now is that they're going to jail with their politicians, and we hope some competitive private sector would develop, but that's not something that we can really rely on, because it simply doesn't exist. If government favoritism is generalized for many decades, there's really no competitive private sector. They all flew long ago. I mean, so I think that this might apply to mediumly corrupt countries, but not to systemically corrupt countries, because there's not much left there. So, returning to the questions, what are the lessons learned for the international anti-corruption communities? What should we, in what direction should we steer countries versus, you know, the bad advice we've been giving them for quite a while?
Sorry to tell you.
No, I think it is, the problem is even more serious. You know, what I see working in this international organization is the problem which I see as the number one problem is the following. You see, we started, developing anti-corruption international convention some 20 years ago. And since then, nothing has changed. It goes like this. You change the legislation, establish or develop new institutions, you fight corruption. Meanwhile, the theory, the academia, has produced so many new insights into what is corruption, how it is possible to fight it, how to improve the governance, how to improve the integrity. And the problem is just is that we, sitting in the Russian community, we simply do not care what you, the scientists, have found out. And this is the problem, because getting ready for this conference here, I learned so many new things, which really opened my eyes. But the problem is that when you try to introduce something new, international organizations, they stick to the text of the conventions as solid gold. Not only because they would all be convinced that this is solid gold, but also because they're afraid that if they would open the Pandora box of any convention, that due to so many different interests of different countries, things might go back to the roots, meaning that the conventions would change to the worse, not to the better, to the worse. The next problem, of course, is that nobody is coordinating international community. You have countries where it is very popular that international community comes running in. When I say comes running in, I mean different international organizations, different countries, throwing in huge amounts of money, no control, but also no coordination of what do we want the country to achieve. I worked in Afghanistan, this is a typical case of the country. Now, the same thing is happening in Ukraine. You have so many international organizations running around in Ukraine with lots of money, which are not coordinated at all. So why wouldn't we sit down and say, okay, we want Ukraine to achieve this, this, and this. But please, don't stop at changing the legislation or establishing new anti-corruption institutions. Anytime in the last 2 years when I got back to Ukraine, they had a new anti-corruption institution. For sure. And none of them was functioning properly. Now they have one which is raising some hopes. But we'll see. So if we don't know how to coordinate ourselves, you can imagine how confused the beneficiary countries are when we're coming in, and today we are asking them to do one thing, tomorrow the next international organization will come and ask them to do something else. What do they think about us? What do they think about us when they see that in the first half of the budgetary year, they cannot get 1 euro because international organizations are sitting the money saving in for the last day of the budgetary year? And then in the last quarter of the budgetary year, international organizations are coming to them, begging them, please do accept our money because we have to spend the money, otherwise we will not be able to say that we have helped you in fighting corruption. So there are so many things which we can do by just coordinating our efforts. And then things would for sure look much better.
Two key principles in development is
use what you've got and do no harm. And I think that must apply to anti-corruption as well. What you see is that essentially context, despite all kind of rhetoric that we individualize and tailor-make our programs, what you see is that both international organizations, bilaterals, multilaterals, and private sector, because you've got a cottage industry for anti-corruption and consulting and so on, all they do is apply off-the-shelf solutions that have no local buy-in, that are not integrated, that are not strategically coherent, and of course they will fail. So what you have is the need for local buy-in. And what that requires in countries like Greece is reversing the brain drain. Use what you've got is use the human capital that you keep losing. This country is bleeding to death with the people who are leaving one after the other. They have to come back. On anti-corruption, there are Greeks all over the place. Why can we not come together and do something actually about this place, right? So that context, respect for context, local buy-in and involvement, I think is key for international organizations that really care about outcomes, not just outputs. The other thing is managing expectations. So you do not overpromise, underdeliver, frustrate, and demoralize the youth. What you gotta do is promise what pragmatically can be accomplished. It has to be step by step. It has to be a long-term project. So whatever plan and promises are conveyed to the public, they have to be done on the basis of a capacity and needs assessment, so that you show with little steps that you're moving towards the final goal, and that is how you build credibility, legitimacy, and momentum. And the final thing is, how do you do this? With indicators like the ANTICORRP program, the performance indicators, and you can develop additional ones. We'll be talking about this tomorrow morning. But that is where you actually involve the different stakeholders. That is where you use the academics. That is where you use civil society. That is where you empower. That is where you have true, genuine democracy and participation. When you get a sense that what you do counts, what you do makes a difference, and that is what is actually going to motivate the youth to stay where they are and fight. It was another survey that was done in Greece, and they found that 14% of university-age Greeks thought that, only 14% thought that by staying in Greece, they would help the Greek society. The overwhelming majority thought that even if they thought altruistically about helping this country, they would have to go first abroad and then return. That has to change.
Absolutely. Paschalis, do you want to take this? Please.
As I was listening, I have a feeling that the atmosphere is getting rather heavy from what you have been saying. I was reminded of a documentary I saw a few years, not so long ago, called Inside Story, about the role of experts and consultants and advisors in the banking crisis in the United States around 2008. I saw that film. I think it even received an Oscar for documentary. I saw it in London, and I was totally devastated, because I saw all those great scholars, including the president of Harvard University, who were producing expert advice work just on the basis of the wishes of their employers. And if that is the case in a country like the United States, with a strong civil society, what I was saying before, and standards of public rectitude and law observance and so forth, then one realizes how difficult the problem is in building up these alliances to fight corruption, to contain the tendency towards practices which may undermine public uprightness, the rule of law, and so forth, and especially in containing the tendency not to break the law but to sidestep it, to find ways to go around the law and do whatever may serve some kind of public private interest, which is the first step to corruption. And that was a kind of very sobering evidence that I saw in front of me as to the nature and the problems, the moral problems, faced by all these societies which are developed at the forefront of the contemporary world, and still they cannot somehow bring themselves to control all these tendencies. So it's not Romania, it's not Greece, it's the United States. And with the Panama Papers now, we see that that is a very widespread phenomenon from all these developed countries.
Well, Paschalis, you brought it on yourself this time, because now I'm going to put the question that I generally get at the end of our policy presentations, generally from the youngest expert in the Dutch government, who's been our employer for the past month since we had the Dutch presidency. And this younger person at absolutely each dissemination event of our report from the Dutch presidency just steps up at the end after we've been discussing in detail techniques and very constructive things. And in the end, he asks, don't you actually think it's a question of culture, really? And some cultures are really not fit for good governance. So you have always been a critic of the Orthodox Church, really, in the Balkans, the first I read. So my question is really, is anything about culture in this?
Well, is it really? Is it really? Because now I was referring to the example of illustrated by the documentary Inside Story, which is talking about the United States, about America. It's not talking, and that's why I said, it doesn't talk about Romania or about Greece, where you could bring in all of those cultural factors, most of the time misunderstood, as explanatory variables. And I may also remember an old story from my graduate school days when an anthropologist published a book on southern Italy called Amoral Families, Edward Banfield, yes? And all of us, you know, progressive scholars at the time were offended that that region of Europe was stigmatized for just doing everything on the criterion of the interest of the family, as Banfield had had argued. But is that explains part of the story. It illustrates, I think, this question of private self-seeking at this sort of level of the family and its interests. But still, I don't think you can explain it only in terms of cultural factors. It has to do more, I think, with the nature of politics and the kind of standards and principles that have some kind of normative appeal in setting sort of behavior of people and the way people understand what they are doing. And I very often sort of recall when I think on this political level what Max Weber writes in the famous essay Politics as a Vocation on all these questions. And it is a question of politics, a question of political leadership, and educating societies accordingly.
I would like to distinguish three things: national character, culture, and values. They are very different things and they get mixed up, because we're talking about X country that is more corrupt than another, as if you can characterize, generalize entire countries, especially big ones, even the small ones, as being corrupt. as if you cannot find integrity anywhere in that society. I have not seen a single society where you do not find people with integrity, okay? Then you have the values, and then you have the culture that actually organizes these values and tells you what is right and wrong when these values conflict. Okay, that is where we have differences. We don't have conflict of values from place to place. Everybody cares about family. Everybody cares about their village, their clan, their friends, their political supporters, sponsors, and so on. The question is how values are articulated, acted out, and when they conflict, how they're resolved. So the challenge that is where societies differ. That makes the task of changing things for more integrity and accountability both more challenging and easier. It's easier because you don't have to go in a patronizing way to teach people integrity. That is unacceptable and it will never work. Secondly, what makes it more difficult is to take those same values that the organization of the values, the resolution of the conflicts of values that have developed out of particular contextual factors and see how changing the context in parallel, you change the reorientation of values in a way that we have better harmony rather than asymmetry that we have today. So that is the task. How can we take the common values and work out the things in sustainable ways? And sustainable means, again, respect for context. So that is our job, to disentangle these confusions, provide the data and the guidance, and work with the other stakeholders to make things different.
Thank you, that is...
And also get allies in the political world.
Surely. Put the message out, absolutely. Before I open up, I have one last delicate question, actually. I just noticed that our Luxembourg whistleblower is coming to trial very soon, and also that the French journalist who hosted the Luxembourg journalist is also coming to trial, right? And Luxembourg, again, is no Romania, is no Greece, is the country where our president of the European Commission has been a prime minister, right? Mm-hmm. So what do we do about this? Where is the critical mass in Luxembourg? I don't think in Bucharest they would be able to put him to trial. Enough of us would be able to stage a rally to prevent this. But I'm rather worried about Luxembourg. What happens if this major whistleblower actually is sentenced?
Well, he already gave the testimony, so now everybody's expecting the sentence, which might be quite significant. I will just add something to what you've said already. No, in the Panama Papers, there are some 400 banks which have established shell companies through the famous Panama Company. And on the list of the 10 banks which have established the majority of the shell companies are four from Luxembourg, the first two from Luxembourg. So this is not just happening. You know, it looks, it is obvious that for Luxembourg that was, let's say, dealing with tax issues in the way from which Luxembourg as a state has profited a lot was not an accident. It was a very clear and intentional decision. And I agree with you that some similar things would never happen in Romania. But you know, the problem is that in so-called, let's say, developing countries, the sensitivity is much bigger than in some old EU member states, simply due to the double standards which are in force. If the original 10 EU member states were never asked to fulfill the standards which the following 15 and afterwards the next ones were asked to fulfill. So they were left behind. Nobody was asking them to do anything in the same way as the countries which were trying to exceed the EU had to do. And we, the new countries, when we were getting into the EU, we were trying to fight this without success. So the testimony of the whistleblower was a real disappointment, you know, because just some days before his testimony, he was simply underlying again and again that he is proud that he did it and that he would do it again. When he gave his testimony, he changed it, I will not say completely, but changed it in the way, obviously as suggested by his defense lawyers, that the punishment would not be so severe. The issue of whistleblowing is also very popular nowadays. But again, you know, the countries allow whistleblowers to be protected only to the extent when they're harming their interests. There was one of the German TV stations has produced 45 minutes, let's say, film on whistleblower protection. The findings are very clear. Now, as much as you speak about the issue of whistleblower protection, you will find in all the international conventions, the last ones, the requirements to countries, you have to protect the whistleblowers. But none of the convention says how. You will not say, you will not find any criteria when you can assess the whistleblower protection in a specific country as a good one, as an effective one. When we tried to do it in the OECD, we got blocked by some of the, let's say, most important countries of the world. Again, they didn't want to have substantial criteria where international community would be telling countries, if you do this, then your whistleblower protection is fine. If you don't do it, it's not fine. Why? The reason is very clear. They want to make decisions which whistleblowers will be protected and which ones will not be protected.
This is turning into lots of ideas for the next round of research here. But you may not know, or you may already know, that the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists is making all the Panama Papers data available today, online, searchable. So there you go crazy. There's going to be lots of information there, so plenty of raw material for research. On the whistleblower, what is interesting is that we are, you know, collectively schizophrenic about this. We love and hate whistleblowers. And it is an important function. You have to convey somehow the idea that when you see something wrong, you need to stand up and hold people to account for it. On the other hand, when people snitch, they're treated as traitors, squeals, they spill their guts, they spill their beans, and we have all kinds of derogatory words to assign to that. There was an interesting master's thesis that was done in Germany, and the student actually did, it was a linguistic study that looked into ways of conveying that message of social responsibility in a way that is acceptable in different cultures. In different languages, because as Drago mentioned, this is required to have whistleblower protection under multiple international instruments. Okay, this is mandatory. But what that means in practice is that you do that at your own risk. Maybe your family's career, sometimes life. And even in OECD countries, you can't be secure in this. Right? So the question is, how the difficulty, the challenge with that thesis is that it's not publicly available. It got privatized because it was incorporated into the business model of a consulting company, and they have not shared that dissertation. I think we have to redo this, in other words. Let's make it open source somehow. How do we convey this important message in a contextually acceptable way so that you're not embarrassed to actually talk about something that is inappropriate and you do get the protection that you deserve when you do the right thing?
Thank you. Let's open up for questions in this moment from our audience. If there are people who want to make a question or to make a comment, yes.
Many questions.
Davide, then Dmitri, then Mishi, and then I move.
Hi, so my name is Davide.
Oh, please wait a second. The microphone is on your
side. Not the microphone. So it's about culture. I mean, it's a point I wanted to develop. Being myself an anthropologist, I'm leader of the WPIFOR, which is the anthropological study of corruption. So it's a very interesting discussion. I thank you very much for all your contribution. I mean, I think there are a lot of things we can learn out from this discussion, but starting from the anthropological perspective, I mean, in our group we have done research on 7 world countries. So world country means not only Europeans, because we had 1 African and 1 South American country. Basically, we adopted a similar pattern in all these countries, starting first with a kind of survey questionnaire, which was not very much quantitative, but it was in order to it was useful, to find out issues and topics. And then we had done with the typical ethnographic research. It was mostly kind of interviews and focus group and everything like this. One of the interesting findings of this research done together with more than 1,000 people is that people in countries which tend to be labeled as rather corrupt countries, they are very much aware about the cost, about the damages of corruption. They are very much aware about the societal, ethical cost of corruption, right? So, I mean, and the other point was about culture. But I am rather skeptical as an anthropologist, like about this really to made pre-confession and the kind of explanation of corruption, which made that. I mean, that's about culture. I mean, many people repeated that during the interviews. And by the way, the interviews were done mostly with public administrators. It was not people from the street, because people from the street have some different cognition about corruption, I believe. So, I mean, people themselves realize that culture is not what explains corruption. Culture is actually what can help for fighting corruption. So, and on this point, I find your remark about development very, very useful here, because we know very well, I mean, as an anthropologist, we know very well that one of the most kind of corrected flows of development was the fact that development was done wrong because there was no real knowledge of the local culture. So going back to these kind of cases we have seen today, Luxembourg and all these kind of Panama leaks, the Una oil and all kind of things, we are perhaps experiencing this kind of idea that culture is not an explanation, because if not, how come that this person coming from very non-corrupted countries, they are actually experiencing these kind of things? And the final point I wanted to make, you, because I have the privilege myself of being a professor at a business school, and I teach business integrity, which is located in one part, which is not exactly very, very, very well known for integrity, which is Hungary. So, and one of the points which my students ask me when I'm trying to teach them about business integrity, they say, yes, okay, you are talking about Eastern Europe, which is plagued by corruption. You are talking about this. But then, like, we are showing data about the top corporate fines, paid by multinational corporations, 90%, they are coming from countries like Japan, France, Germany, US.
Yeah. Dimitri, please.
Thank you very much. I'm Dimitri Sotiropoulos. I participate in Work Package 11. And I would like to make a general comment and a specific comment. The general comment is related to this very wonderful range of views we have heard about anti-corruption and whether it works or not. I think it comes out of this discussion, as well as out of our work, as it will be shown tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, that there are major intervening variables which determine to a large extent whether anti-corruption will be successful or not. And some of these intervening variables, which must be researched in the context of each country, are obviously, first of all, the interplay between governments and public opinion. Secondly, the political party competition, where parties use anti-corruption as a tool in their electoral campaigns. And thirdly, among many other variables, one should also factor in mass media, newspapers, and TV channels, which compete to bring up a story, and then they themselves make sure that the story dies, by which I mean an anti-corruption story. The specific point has to do about Greece. I would like to sketch a more varied image of Greece. Indeed, as our panelists have mentioned, we have some points of excellence, and that example already mentioned, the example of transparency, is a major example. Namely, all administrative acts of the Greek central, regional, and local public administration are uploaded on the internet, and without such an uploading, the act does not become valid. On the other hand, there are some dark sides, some spots, which clearly make Greece look more corrupt than perhaps it really is, and I refer to the problem of tax evasion as the major example. However, I would like, just to finish this comment, to remind everyone that in this country now, as we speak, the former deputy Prime Minister of Greece is in prison. The former General Secretary of the Defense of defense ministry is in prison. The former mayor of Thessaloniki was in prison, and three former ministers, of which two were ministers of finance, have been condemned in prison, sorry, have been condemned in court, not in prison, but to pay fines because of violating the asset verification laws. Mm-hmm. In addition, if you take a look at opinion data, and that includes both Transparency International data and victimization studies, people have noticed. In this country, after the crisis started, we have seen an upsurge of perception of corruption, namely that corruption has expanded. And then, as time went on and the crisis went on, the not always failed, but sometimes successful efforts of Greek governments to fight corruption have led to a change that is a shift of opinion. Now, fewer Greeks than in the past believe that the country is corrupt. Yet, one has, of course, to take into account how Greece fares in comparative perspective and understand that in that, on that count, Greece may still rank very lowly. Thank you.
Thank you. Mishi, please.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I would like to make a personal comment and then a more general question to the panel. So I started off 5 years ago at ANTICORRP as probably many of you, like, driven by perceptions of corruption that, well, Eastern European countries and, in fact, most of the globe is highly corrupt, and then we have a handful of countries really rich, non-corrupt, like Denmark and the UK and you know, the usual suspects. Now, as we progress more and more with these leaks, with this objective data and indicators we develop, I'm becoming worried that Switzerland is sinking in stolen money, or the city of London is actually bankrupting the UK government, because indeed these well-governed countries are deeply in it, right? I mean, probably it would be really hard for Putin doing the kind of kleptocratic way of running a country without the help of the city of London, without the help of some well-governed countries. And then there is academic research on, you know, Denmark, family ties to elected officials, increased firm value, and all sorts of evidence. So my worry is that the high standards we have been looking up to are not there at all. And then my question, which directly follows from this, and I have no research on this, is just an open question, is that maybe anti-corruption, successful anti-corruption, is not about eradicating corruption or having high integrity elites. Rather, having elites which are disciplined enough to do something good to the wider society, why they steal or why they do their usual business. So really, what do you think is, you know, success in anti-corruption in this context?
Okay, very good provocative question. I will take Munir and then I'll return to the panel. Okay, and that question there.
Gina Corella, I work in the area of corporate social responsibility. As you know, one of the 10 principles of Global Compact for companies to follow is the work for anti-corruption. My question, I heard two members of the panel referring to how we could find allies in the private sector in our work for anti-corruption and how we could give incentives. I would be interested to know whether the OECD or the EU have any strategic plans in this area. Thank you.
Thank you. Munir.
Thank you very much. My name is Munir Podmilak. I come from Croatia. I'm more of the activist, so I'll just pose, maybe play as a devil's advocate here on a few issues. First, in terms of the where do we go, how do we turn this trend where countries sometimes, basically many countries, don't want to change, and they play that as they, like, just for protection of their image, but they don't want. We look into something that we call social capture, basically where we all, including civil society, us anti-corruption experts and media, all of those protection and accountability or external control mechanisms play a certain role in corruption. We all play to satisfy a certain audience, which could be considered to be clientelism at the end, because we exchange our powers in terms for some kind of benefit. But the other thing is, which is more important, Panama Papers. Why don't we look at that as a reverse model? Because I looked at that. We do work on investigating actual stories of corruption and all of that. And I looked, and first thing that struck me on the Western Balkans and Croatia is that only marginal people are there. Only marginal power brokers are in the papers. Why? Because our politicians designed their own perfect corrupt system, and they don't trust the banks that where they didn't appoint the manager. They will never put money in Panama or South America where some kind of revolution can really create disaster and they lose it all. They designed their own bank, their own rules. Designed the rules during the accession period so that, for example, our accountability institutions can check their accounts on the banks, then Constitutional Court annulled this decision. So they are completely safe keeping their bank, keeping their stolen money, corrupt money, in middle of the downtown Zagreb without moving it, but they appoint the managers there. So, you know, the safe thing is safe. You design the perfect corrupt system. So when we look and or research Panama Papers, maybe this aspect should be looked at. Maybe we could find out that more systemic corruption now, Eastern Europe, especially Southern Eastern Europe, will have less people there, no prime minister, only marginal people, because we do already have perfect corrupt systems. There is no need to move this money in uncontrolled areas. Just.
Yeah, thank you, Mickey. I mean, if you have your own islands, why bother to go to Panama or Virgin Islands, right? And definitely some of us come from countries which have plenty of islands where we appoint governors. Please, no.
Just a sentence on this one. We must not forget that there is one country where absolutely nobody coming from this country, which can be found in the Panama Papers, and this is the United States of America. So if we apply your theory to that, to look funny.
Go on.
You know, starting from the last point, you know, local arrangements for similar problems, you can conceivably also deal with income tax evasion by abolishing income. Then you don't have any income to tax, and then there's no invasion. But that's not a real solution. When it comes to the Panama Papers, it's important to remember that that company that got hacked is not the biggest in the market, okay? So it is a window to how the world really works, but a small one, not the biggest one. There is more to know. And I hope that Anonymous or others may be able, or insiders in other companies may feel a similar kind of moral obligation to disclose what is happening elsewhere. But what you mentioned is true. In fact, there were questions as to why there are not so many American names in the Panama Papers. Well, we have Delaware. We have other jurisdictions, Nevada, and so on. So you don't have to go to Panama to do what you can do at home. And there are also European and other jurisdictions where you can do similar kind of things. But I think it takes us back to the point that a lot of this is legal. You have to see that we have to go back to the drawing board on what is okay and what is not. And this distinction of tax planning and tax avoidance separately from tax evasion, when the bottom line is that people and lower income people bear the burden of these people doing their planning, well, maybe we should redo their planning in a different way, right? I mean, you have billionaires in the United States, like Buffett and others, who say, I should be taxed more. I shouldn't be having to pay less taxes than my secretary, all right? On the question of playing theater on different countries, it is true that a lot of countries are just going to go through the motions, introduce institutions and laws, because otherwise they're not going to get bilateral or other money. I mean, this is openly admitted in multiple countries around the world. There's no theater. It's not a secret. That replicates, actually, what used to be done on money laundering, anti-money laundering. For many years, FATF had a methodology on how we assess the implementation practices in countries, and all we would see is there a financial intelligence unit? Is there a law? Is there someone there? But the question was never asked, is it doing anything? Is it catching dirty money?
Is it recovering assets? Is it reducing crime? Again, this is what I was saying earlier about looking at outputs and not outcomes. Why do we have the FIU? Why do we have anti-money laundering in place? And unfortunately, we're doing the same thing with anti-corruption right now. We have to, I hope that we're not going to have to wait this long for the VATF and others. Now they have gone into effectiveness measurements of anti-money laundering laws and terrorism finance and the rest of it. But we have to do that with anti-corruption. And finally, the question of what standards do we abolish corruption and so on. We never will. I mean, Durkheim told us many years ago that, you know, crime is part of society. Even in a society of states, you have deviants. But the perfect is the enemy of the good. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that you don't do anything about the problem, and it doesn't mean that you cannot do better. And every single society can do better. And we should, especially in this room, remember that when we talk about corruption, it's a blanket concept, and it covers all kinds of malpractices and misconduct. Some of these are actually institutionalized in some parts of the world. What we're talking about is different types of corruption, different kinds of problems, and every single country, including the OECD countries, have a lot of room for improvement. And it is this improvement that we have to work on. Thank you.
Well, we'll try to respond to your question about the incentives for the companies. You see, in the OECD, we are really putting a lot of emphasis on this question. The problem is that until now, we just have the incentives when something already went wrong. If you take a look, let's see, in the US, they have the federal sentencing guidelines. In the UK and Italy, they have the legislation which is saying if the companies have had effective compliance system in place where the bribery has happened, then can be, they will not be sanctioned. But this is when it happens already, and this is not something which we are satisfied with. Because when it happens already, it happened. So the problem is there already. So what we are trying to do now, we are trying to introduce positive incentives, such as, let's say, that companies who would be really taking care about their, let's say, compliance systems, business integrity, would be rewarded by, let's say, only them taking part in public procurement procedures or earning extra points in the public procurement procedures and similar things. We have had the case of Italy where something similar was already praised. So now we are starting phase four. This year we will try to introduce this through practice, meaning that companies we should be rewarding, no, countries we should be rewarding companies in a positive sense, they would be set as a good example. The problem is that we still have countries where they don't do anything to make the position of the companies which are trying to do something better. And when I say anything, it means literally anything. They don't have anything in place, even if they have the best possible compliance system in place, if one of their responsible persons will be caught accepting or giving bribes, they will still receive the full portion. And this is something which we have to change. But as I said already, the level of mistrust between government, not between, the level of mistrust which governments are applying towards the companies is so huge that we will need some time for that. And just at the end, because I think this is my last intervention, you see, I'm sure that you know on Thursday the United Kingdom government is organizing the World Anti-Corruption Summit. And I saw some initial ideas what the outcomes of the summit should be. So, and the basic idea was that let's push forward, not in the area of legislation, the institutional setup, but in the area of practical achievements. So not what is the input, but what are the results. And I'm quite curious what will happen on Thursday, because I'm sure that the good or the best ideas which the UK government has had to be then coordinated, discussed, negotiated with some other countries, or not with some, with countries taking part at the same meeting. And I'm afraid that, I'm still optimist, but I'm afraid that the end result would be much weaker than the initial ideas at the beginning. But I hope I'm wrong.
Thank you. Paschalis, any final word?
Please. Very brief final remark. I was very pleased to hear the general impression that emerges from the anthropological study on culture. And I think we have to stress this, that both culture and religion are important, but and are essential components of the social reality around us, but they're also very malleable phenomena. And therefore, they cannot really be made into explanatory variables, but they play a kind of intervening role. And I think this brings us back to the question of the power of politics in shaping up these particular components of social reality, religion, and culture.
Thank you. Thank you. So I would sort of sum this up in 1 minute. I think that the lessons coming out clearly out of this, what we should take home, apart questions that we still have left unanswered, are the importance of context. Context seems to be really everything, which justifies, of course, very thorough research by country. The question of domestic coalitions, you have to have a coalitions of people who really have an interest to change a context. Nobody from outside can do it. Actually, outside can, you know, if we have seen in Afghanistan or Ukraine, can sometimes do more harm than good. So unless there is this domestic agency that you can put up in a coalition, no hope. You have to have substantial legislation. I mean, legislation of the type that former Estonian Prime Minister Mart Laar was telling us in an interview, legislation which is preventive, which prevents people with authority to convert it into wealth. That is the moment when you have to act. All the post afterwards legislation, you know, it's really, you know, may get someone in jail if it finally gets enforced as in Romania, but it really doesn't change practices. It becomes far more difficult to do it otherwise. And finally is this issue of sustainability. In the course of ANTICORRP, we studied the 7 global achievers, countries which managed to move from particularism to good governance in the past 30 years. And in none of these countries that I visited myself, I had the impression that it's a Panama kind of place, like Luxembourg. In all of them, people were really full of emulation and very proud of what they have achieved. And I have seen this in Uruguay, I have seen this in Estonia, I have seen this in Korea. So where people really struggled in the last 30, 40 years to change regime, people are very much aware and defending what they've got. I think there's a problem in older democracies, which have achieved this equilibrium quite a while ago. Their people have started simply to take it for granted. And when it's taken for granted, very much looks what happens. So in fact, you know, control of corruption is built domestically, but it quite needs sustaining from civil society and media and interest. And with this, we thank very much the panelists and you, a great audience, and everyone who tuned in from different places to watch us online. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you for coordinating.
You are great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well,
you're wonderful. I learned a great deal.
We'll do this, we'll do this again. We'll do this again, yes.
It's also important for me, you know, because I really was fighting for
which,
years.
Which one?
Right. Oh, the corruption, the cultural issue.
Oh, yes. 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 Yes.